something more than once to actually get it. And I'm fully aware that I'm the last obstacle between you and the end of the day, so I try to keep it short and light. What you see here is a cartoon of the climate system. Again, you can see that it is composed of the ocean, the atmosphere, the land ice, the sea ice, vegetation, clouds. So it's a very complex system. It spans a wide range of spatial and temporal scales. And we cannot always include everything in any of our models. So I'll just talk a little bit about some aspects of it. I will start again from the conclusion. We know that all models are wrong, but still I will try to show you that some of them are still useful. And the second point is always to be skeptic. So this is a Japanese cartoon, and they compare the result of the outputs to the calculator in 2000 feet. So actually it's more suspicious of the electrical calculator, the result of the model and so on. Calculations, so it's always good to be skeptic about what we get from the models. Some sources and for other readings, there's a very nice talk, actually I didn't mention, but I borrowed some slides from Peter Frank, Mark Spiegelman, and Eric Zimmerman. So he has a nice talk about the numerical modeling of the marine ecological system. And then there's a general course on the numerical models by Mark Spiegelman. It's available on this website, a very nice course with some demonstrations, some simple codes. And then there are two papers that I already mentioned to you before. And again, just try to give you some examples of some caveat in numerical methods, some problem of stability and instability. It would be a pretty general one. Just especially to those who doesn't come from exact sciences, to get to test a little bit what are the problems. So we will talk first what is a model, and then why we did, why we use these models, how to do it. Then I will give a very brief introduction to bifurcation, to stability, and we'll talk a little bit about numerical methods. We'll talk a little bit some examples of use and abuse of numerical models, and some. So of course there are many definitions for models. Just some of you will be fair that I will talk on different kinds of models than what I'm going to talk on today. But if you take two of these entries, it's sort of a system of some data and just some connection to describe the interrelation between all of these variables. Basically, a model is sort of a bookkeeping. So we have different state variables. It can be nutrient, plankton, some other stocks. And try to keep the flow from one box to another. So basically, it's a sort of a bookkeeping. More generally, we have some sort of equation, some governing equation that describe the processes and the relation between, say, phytoplankton and zooplankton, zooplankton and aerotrophic levels, and the nutrient and all this, and the forcing, if we have some external forcing in our system. Another important point that I will mention again later is that we need some initial condition. If you want to take a model and start to do some experiment, we need to give some initial values. This model, and in many cases, the result will be very sensitive to these initial values. If the model has more than one special variables, if it's not a zero dimensional model, then we also need some boundary condition at the end of the domain. If we say model only part of the ocean, only a single sea or something like that. And we have the external forces. It can be the soil radiation, it can be a nutrient supply by river, and so on. There are many reasons or many uses for models. One of them is to test all sorts of hypotheses. So, for example, if we look on ecological models, there are different functional forms for the aspect of nutrient, of the uses of light. So we try and test different functional forms. And it can help us to identify some data gaps, and I try to build a model, and you realize that actually you have no constraint or no data to decide what should be the value of certain parameters that you must put into the equations. It can help you to do all sorts of sensitivity analysis, all sorts of what-if scenarios, what will happen if this presentation is its own life. We will double CO2 in 50 years, or if you do it in 100 years, all different scenarios you can try to check and look in with the model. It can also use in all sorts of fancy statistical method to recover all sorts of information from data. And it's very important for decision making. To summarize in one quote, famous quote by Rumsfeld: there are no knowns, there are known unknowns, there are also unknown unknowns. The ones that we don't know, we don't know. One of the uses, we try to run models and look on all sorts of scenarios, we try to identify the unknown unknowns, and hopefully can reduce the uncertainty that we have in the models that we are using. So the different approach to trying the models. One of them the kitchen sink approach. Just take everything you know, all the state variables, all the rules, put everything together and hope that something good will come out of it. As we heard in the previous talk, problem oriented is a much better approach. We try to make the model as simple as possible. Be problem driven instead of just putting everything. More complex models are not necessarily better. Actually, they have many more uncertain parameters of the result. Not necessarily better. One of the papers that I gave you actually talk about the complexity of ecological models. I really recommend you to read this paper by Ginsburg and his colleague. So actually, as we saw from the previous example, usually I believe that simple models are much better than complicated. So you really should be problem driven, try to keep it as simple as possible, and then make a model that you can really understand the result. There's no point for every model that is as complicated as the real nature, and then it does not make any sense of the result. There's no right model for all problems. Even if you look on a marine ecological system, you will find all sorts of models, NPZ, NPZD, NPZ model with different number of compartments. You know, each one of them fits a different problem, and you cannot just take an existing model and use it for all purposes. It really depends on the question. It depends on the data that you have. You have data on all for all the initial condition for everything, for all the parameters, for all the time scales and spatial scales that they are interested in. The very important part is after you run a model, do a lot of sensitivity tests to your results. So you can run the model, press enter, eventually you will get some result, but it is not clear if what you will get is reasonable. So this is the time to talk a little bit about some surprises and non-linearities in models. So Jacob already mentioned that if you call it a simple model, just a linear system, then it can be more sensitive or less sensitive, but basically you can sort of predict what will be the outcome of the model if you change the forcing, say the amount of CO2 or the amount of solar radiation. Once you have a non-linear system, much less pleasant. You can have all sorts of surprises. It can be exponential growth. You can have some jumps. You can have all sorts of behavior. So I will demonstrate it with a very, very simple example just to show you what we mean by a very large sensitivity of a system. So very, very simple equation. X dot, the time derivative of say variable, the state variable x, depends on mu minus x squared. We try to see if this system, this very simple equation, has some steady state solution. If we have, some steady states, correctly said indeed steady states are what we call stable or unstable. So obviously if the ball is sitting on this top of the mountain, it might be a steady state condition, but it's not very stable because any small changes, perturbation like this ball will shift it from one side to the other. On the other hand, if you are sitting in one of these bodies, these are regarded as a stable. Steady state, sometimes it is called the steady and fixed one. Then the transition from, if you have more than one steady state, the transition can be a gradual, it can be abrupt, it might have some jump from one side to another, it can be due to some stochastic forces, there are also variations. So let's get back to this simple equation. What do we mean by looking for steady state? We just make this term 0. So we have a very simple equation, mu equal x squared, and if mu is 0, we have one steady state, there is only one solution. If mu is larger than 0, then we have two solutions, and if it is smaller than 0, then we have no solutions at all. One way to look or to plot these options is by making figures with x and x dot for different values of mu. So if mu is 0, then we have only one solution for these equations. You can see that if x will be larger than 0 initially, then it will move back to the same as the same solution to 0. But if you will give a negative perturbation, then it will move away. So this is a sort of a unique kind of steady state. If mu is less than 0, we have no solution at all. And if mu is larger than 0, then one of the solutions is indeed stable. So if we give some perturbation from this solution, the ball will come back to the same locations. But if you will do the perturbation for the other solution, it will go completely to run away to the other side. What we can see that by again, the simplest equation, by changing a very little, a small value of a single parameter, so you can get a very, very different qualitative behavior. Now imagine the equation that governs the climate system. We have many non-linearities, we have many parameters like this. It means that if you take if you got some model result, you are very happy with that. Now you change a little bit, you do some sensitivity test, and some of the variables, the parameters, if you are not certain what it should be exactly the values, sometimes we have just the g, the gravity, that we all know the exact value of it, but in many cases we have some parameters that we have some range of uncertainties. You must look at the sensitivity of your model result. Changes in these parameters, and if you get a very different qualitative behavior, you must be very careful. Another way to look, to portray the same qualitative behavior is again to look to plot what we call bifurcation diagrams. So this axis is now the value of mu, and the solid line is in steady solution, and the dashed line is unstable solution. You can see that for mu, smaller than 0, we have an unstable solution. If mu is larger than 0, then we have one stable solution and one unstable solution. Whenever we have some simple model, some nonlinearities, we actually try to do this analysis in order to understand better the behavior, the characteristic of the model that we are using. Even if you take a very, probably the simplest climate model that you can imagine, so again, this is only an energy balance model. The amount of radiation absorbed by the sun is equal to the outgoing longer radiation. It gives sum is relatively simple.